Alright, so let's do a little repeat and review from last time. Last time we talked about some huge ideas, big ideas, and we sort of put it in perspective and we talked about the history. Started with 400,000 years ago with some very, very primitive ideas, you know, approximating with a rectangle, not very bright, not very sophisticated. Going forward a few 100,000 years to the Stone Age, a little better, cut up into a couple more rectangles, still a little better. Until we get to the time of the Greeks, you know, they're doing their philosophy. They got Socrates, Plato, they got it's a thinking fest going on there. It's really a great time to be a thinker in Greece. And right around that time, you got this guy Archimedes who's thinking big, big thoughts. He's thinking that he's going to slice up the area, which is a grown-up area, into little tiny children areas, shape of the rectangles. That is big and bold because there's so many of them and they're so little. They have to be almost close to zero. And so that's much easier said than done. He calls this his method of exhaustion. He actually did it with a circle. I might put that on the actual homework where he tried to find the area of a circle by enclosing triangles. That's a classic problem. And, you know, you could right now you have the tools to do it. A typical calc student could take a stab at that and participate in this epic story of how Archimedes did it a long, long time ago, a couple thousand years ago. Anyways, this required big, bold ideas, you know, cutting it up into infinite little pieces. That's no enchiladas, man. That's like riding the bull. That's what we said last time. And not only did we end up doing it, but we did it with such a clean and elegant theorem. It's amazing. There's a similar story for slopes. Again, that involves some crazy stuff like dividing zero by zero. It's riding the bull. That story took a couple thousand years in the making. It wasn't until the late 17th century till two people, Isaac Newton and Leibniz, got the job done. With this, the jewel of the 17th century, the fundamental theorem of calculus, at least in science. Imagine what this did for us. This fixed the area problem, which touched all other branches of science. It's kind of like inventing sugar for a cook. You know, how many different foods have sugar? And it's as ubiquitous as finding areas for science. And so this was a huge, huge step. And they did it not in a shy way. Oh, no. They did it their way. A very, very nice story. And you should be looking forward to this. A couple more months and we'll be ready to peek into the genius of these gods disguised as men who walked amongst us. Alright, these revolutionary ideas mandate a new type of numbers, a new type of arithmetic. And so I believe that's where we left off. And so I spent all the time thinking about the right way to tell the story, and I think this is so important to see the whole picture, see why we're doing this, why we're doing that, why we're doing that. I can't stop thinking about it. I'm always thinking about better ways of telling a story. You know, sometimes I'll be talking to my wife, or more accurately, she'll be talking to me, and I'll just smile and glance and say yes, but she thinks I'm listening to her, but really, I'm just thinking about the right way to tell the calculus story. I'm possessed. I want to make sure it makes sense. You know, this is why areas are important. This is why it's not easy, because the areas are, you know, curvy shape. The amazing idea, the audacious idea from Archimedes to cut that up into infinite pieces, that brings new problems. It brings the need for a new type of arithmetic. And that, my friends, that's where we're at today. New arithmetic, but if I wanted to repeat and review what we did last time in under 5 minutes, I think that's it. Okay, so that's a repeat and review.
One ticket, please. Round of supervisor.
Today.
Hey, what's going on, man? Yeah.
Today we ride the bull.
Yeah, she's at home.
This is what we gotta do today.
Yeah, she's at home.
Yeah. Let the music play. Alright, so this is what we gotta do today. We've gotta begin to get a hold of this amazing concept, infinity. That's precisely one of the key things that stopped Archimedes from fixing the problem, 2,000 years ago. That's why it took so long to get the problem done. So that's the goal for today. Now, here's one way to look at it. You can think about arithmetic for children, and in this concept, you can think about all the different numbers that you can do arithmetic with, such as 3, 5, 9, 11, and it's pretty simple to do that kind of arithmetic. 3 plus 5 is equal to 8. You see? I told you it's easy. 3 times 11 is equal to 33. See, I told you it's easy. That's arithmetic for children. What sort of things can you do with this type of arithmetic? Well, you could do very mundane things, such as count how many fingers you got. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You could count fish, for example. 1 fish, 2 fish, 3 fish, red fish. You could, if you want to get a little funny, you could count clownfish. 1 clownfish. You could even multiply clownfish. What's 1 clownfish times 3? That's easy to do, even with children arithmetic. A clownfish times 3 would be 3 clownfish. So that's what you can do. The thing that you cannot do with this children arithmetic is you cannot go on and play this this game over here. This game is not for mortals. Well, it is now, but it's not for children. Back then, it wasn't even for any mortal. That's the one thing that you cannot, these things like infinity times zero. It's the one thing you cannot do in this arena here. And so, but that's what we got to do to solve the age-old problem. And so, what we gotta do is we gotta add to our bucket of numbers here. We gotta add some stuff, spice it up. We gotta add zero and infinity in there. Pour it in there. And now we got ourselves a container full of numbers for grown-ups. Grown-up arithmetic. As soon as you mix these guys in there, oh, it's a totally different ballgame. I reminded when I was a little kid, I would go to parties and you have the big bucket for where people could get drinks, and they would always have one labeled not for kids because they had poured some wine or spirits or something in there, alcohol. This is kind of like the same thing. This bucket is not for kids. This is truly a different sort of thing that had never been done before. Okay. In fact, even this concept is hard to tackle. What is infinity? Definition is a number that's not bounded. Well, yeah, a number that's not bounded. There are so many numbers that are not bounded. One thing for sure is we don't call it a real number. Real numbers lie on the number line, and you can spot them. They always have a spot here. Like this is 0, that's a real number. Pi, that's a real number. Square root of 11, that's a real number. Negative 13, that's a real number. Every single number that you can find a spot for on a number line is called a real number. And real numbers, they've got their rules that they play with. I borrowed this from the other class in Math Hands. These are the basic rules. They're called basic axioms. Technical name for it is field axioms. Cancellation laws, associativity laws, reflexive properties, basic things like any number times zero, zero. A bunch of consequences from... But all this is in the arena of real numbers. That's in this land right here for children. As soon as you spice it up a little bit, forget about it. All these rules, all these rules, some of them may work and some of them may not, but the truth is you have to abandon all of them until you can verify each one when you're playing in this arena. So all bets are off. Everything that you knew about numbers, you have to question again when you evolve things like this. Okay? I told you. It's not that easy. So this new numbers and new arithmetic, new perspective, it's going to change a lot of things. One of the things that I think that would be very helpful for us is if we tweak our perspective here. We got to add a new way of looking at numbers. And that's in anticipation of some of the problems that we're going to have. When you add things like infinity, you add paradoxes, obstacles, and limitations that weren't there before. And so we one way to overcome this is to adopt this new way of looking at things. And this one I just proposed myself, but I found it very, very useful. In past classes, I found it very, very useful. In fact, it comes from higher level mathematics, where some of the monumental thinkers of our times have come up with this idea, but I just try to make the idea adoptable for our class, so here goes, okay? What we do is we no longer think about a number like 5 just as 5. Instead, we think about it as a bucket of numbers. And in this bucket, we just throw a lot of things in there, not just 5. We throw things that are infinitely close to 5, like 5.00000, many, 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 many zeros, maybe infinite many of them, and a 1. That goes this so close to 5 that it gets thrown in the 5 bucket. Okay, that's a brand new concept, but it's needed so that we can, do arithmetic over here with infinity. But more than that, think about this number, 5.00000. What if there's infinite many zeros here, and then at the end there's a 7? Well, that's pretty darn close to 5, so we'll throw it in the 5 bucket. Or even things like 4.9999. If it stopped there, well, it would go in the 4.999 bucket. But if it keeps going on forever and ever and ever, well, you might as well throw it into the 5 bucket, because it's going to get there as close as you want it to get to 5. See that? Even if there was a 3 over here, as long as there's infinite many 9s here, it'll be in the 5 bucket. So you start to throw everything that's really, 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 really close to 5 in there. And then you start to think about 5 no longer as just 5, but the bucket that contains all numbers that are infinitely close to 5. Here, one way to think about it is a number, this is no longer 5, it's just a number that's really, 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 really close to 5. You don't just do that for 5, of course. You do that for all possible numbers. 1.75, no longer just that, it's a bucket. It's a bucket that contains things like 1.7, 4.99999. It's in there. It's in the 1.75 bucket. Etc. etc. What numbers would be here in the 1 bucket? Well, 1.00000 with a 1, or 0.9999. That goes in the 1 bucket as well. You see how it goes? You getting the hang of it? Everything's a bucket. And there are more interesting buckets here. The 0 bucket would be 0.000007, for example. So long as you got infinite many of these here, that gets thrown in the 0 bucket. You could go from negative 0.000001, that gets thrown in the 0 bucket. The 0 bucket is the only one that contains both positive and negative numbers, but they're really, really close to 0. You can almost think about it this way. Here's a different take on it. You imagine the number line here, and imagine here's a 0. No longer do you think about 0 as just 0, but you think about it as a little tiny neighborhood that's incredibly small, and everything that lands in there gets thrown into the 0 bucket. But you have to get really, really close to it, okay? This is a picture of the real number line, or this is a different way to conceptualize it. It's a bucket with everything that's infinitely close to it. I know it seems kind of strange, but believe me, this will make you powerful. You just think about buckets for everything, okay? This will save the day. This is a very, very deep and powerful way to look at it. 3, 5, 7, negative 5, pi, everything that you can think about, 1.2, it's a bucket, okay? The fancy name for this is called equivalence classes. Equivalence classes. I teach it in higher, higher level mathematics, but they don't ever teach it here just because they can't think about a good bucket example or analogy like we did here. Let me show you the power of it, okay? In this new type of arithmetic using buckets, some of the new arithmetic will match the old arithmetic. It'll be almost the same. And the reasoning will go something like this. If I have a number that's really, really, really close to 3, I don't care which number from that bucket I choose, any number that's really, really close to 3 plus, or no, times a number that's really, 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 really close to 5, I don't care which one it is, if it's really, really close to 5, the product will definitely be a number that's really, 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 really close to 15. You see how that works? There's nothing new here. In some cases, the new arithmetic, the new way of looking at things, matches exactly the old one. Told you. Here. Suppose I gave you a number that's really, really, really close to 1. Any number that's really, really close to 1 plus any other number that's really, 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 really close to 2. What do you think you'll get? Well, you'd get a number that's really, 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 really close to 3. Uh-huh. Told you. Suppose you take a number that's really, really close to 1.25 times a number that's really, really close to 4. Of course, you're going to get a number that's really, really close to 5. Pretty easy, right? I told you, sometimes the near arithmetic matches the old one. And even this one is not that bad. An unbounded number, this is infinity, a large, 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 large number that's unbounded, plus 3, what will that give you? It wouldn't matter which large number you pick from the unbounded bucket and which number you pick from the numbers that are infinitely close to 3. The result is going to be clear, and it should be clear to everybody, that you will get an unbounded number again. Because you had one unbounded to begin with. All you did was add 3 to it. Well, it's even more unbounded now. Make sense? So it'd be in the infinity bucket. This is strange about the infinity bucket. It has so many things in there. It's got infinities in there. It's got infinity plus 3s in there. It's got infinity minus 1,000 is in there. Have you guys ever heard of the bottles of beer on the wall song? 100 bottles of beer on the wall, 100 bottles of beer. You take one down, you pass it around, 99 bottles of beer on the wall, 99 bottles of beer on the wall, you take one down, you pass it around, 98 bottles of beer. If you had infinite many bottles of beer on the wall, you pass one down, how many bottles of beer do you have left? Infinite again. Amazing. If you subtract one, you still have infinite many. Again, sometimes a new arithmetic matches the old one. Let's think about this one. Something really, really close to 31 times something really, really, really close to 0. Well, you're going to get something really, really, really close to 0. There's no surprise there. Okay? Something really, really close to pi times something really, really close to 3. You get something really, really close to pi times 3. Or 3 pi. Infinity minus something unbounded. You take 45 away from it, still unbounded. Still infinity. It's still in the infinity bucket. Same thing here. Infinity bucket. Oh, this is too easy. Alright, here it starts to get more interesting. What if you took 2 and raised it to the infinity? What in the world does that mean? Here's one way to think about it. The infinity is just a large number. It's an unbounded number. So this would be 2 times 2 times 2 times... Here's one way to look at it. An unbounded number of times. What do you suppose you'd get if you took 2 times 2 times 2? An unbounded number of times, and then you keep going unbounded number of times. Well, you get a large number. It'd be in the infinity bucket. So 2 to the infinity is infinity in our new quote-unquote arithmetic. It's probably what you would expect. Even if you lowered it down to 1.3, that's like taking 130% times 130% times 130%. And you do this infinite many times. Well, it keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And you can get as big as you want. One way to see if it'll ever grow forever, you can think, will it ever get past 100? Yeah. You can even do it on a calculator. Will it ever get past 10,000? Yes. Will it ever get past 5 million? Yes. You can actually solve these problems. And you will see that... Should I do it now? I don't know how many details I want to show you. Yeah, take my word for it. And we'll do this later. Or maybe I'll put it on the homework. Does this ever really grow indefinitely forever? The answer is yes. It'll go in the infinity bucket. You might have to do a little bit of homework for that. That's okay. But this goes off to infinity. On the other hand, if you make it less than zero, you take 95% of 95, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And the question is, how small does it get? Well, it'll go into the zero bucket eventually. For some of you, that may be common sense. For some of you, you may have to do a little bit more thinking to convince yourselves. And I may post that on the... It's a very, very interesting, super famous homework problem. When I write the homework, which I haven't. It's only two hands, man. I don't have 20 hands. Just two. But boy, this would be a good problem. Does it ever get to, say, a quarter? Does it ever get to 1/10,000th? Does it get really, really as close as you want it to the zero bucket? The answer is yes, it will. This is super famous. Whenever it's an absolute value smaller than one to the infinity, I think it will go to zero. If it's larger than one, it'll blow off into infinity, just such as the previous one. Anyways, sometimes it's not that hard to figure out. You take negative 5 divided by, you can think about it this way. Negative 5 divided by, just the way I'm saying, thinking about it. Large, unbounded number. Well, that's going to go in the zero bucket for sure. Because if you take any number like negative 5 divided by a large number, you're making it smaller and smaller and smaller. The quotient will get smaller, so that would be in the zero bucket. One way to see this is take 5 and divide it. Actually, try it by a large number, 7 million, for example, and see what happens. And see what happens. And then try it by an even larger one and see what happens. And then you try to think about what would happen if the bottom one is so large that it's unbounded. And hopefully you can see that you'll get in the zero bucket. Anyway, that's a few examples of some of the things that are almost match the old arithmetic. But the new arithmetic also presents some fundamental challenges. Okay, these fundamental challenges occur when sometimes the outcome of a certain operation is not clear. When that happens, we call these intermediate forms, and those are the most important ones, fundamental challenges. For example, 0 divided by 0, we talked about this one before. This is a chameleon. It could be so many things. That's what presented the problem originally. And so that's why we invented this whole new arithmetic, just so we could deal with issues like that. Infinity times 0, we talked about this before, the werewolf and the vampire. Infinity minus infinity. Let's take a look at this one. If you have a large number minus another large number, possibly another large number from the same bucket, what number would you get? Listen to the ambiguity. How many different large numbers are there in the bucket? Well, there's infinite many of them. There are all kinds of different large numbers. Not all infinities are created equal. That's the problem. So I take something from this bucket and I take something else from the bucket. They may be different things. Maybe this, the thing I took here was infinity plus 3, and maybe this one was exactly the same kind of infinity, so when you subtract it, maybe you got 3. Well, maybe. But maybe I had infinity plus 5, and the other infinity that I subtracted was just infinity, so maybe it's 5. Well, maybe. Or maybe the infinity that I had here was infinity plus infinity, and this one was just the same type of infinity as that one, and when I subtracted, I got infinity. Well, maybe. You see how controversial it is? Even for a layman person with a layman attitude, if you said, hey, if I've got a large number in my pocket and I subtract another large number in my pocket, how much would I get? A layman person should be able to say, who knows, man? There's so many large numbers. I don't know what kind of large number you got in your pocket. Could be anything. So this is yet another intermediate forms. And there's about 7 famous ones. But I think I would be doing a disservice to you if I just list all 7 indeterminate forms. Although I already listed 1, 2, 3, maybe I list one more. Should I let you peek at another one? This one. There you go, 4 of them. There's a total of 7, but the other ones I may post on the homework or on the quiz. For sure, I already posted on the quiz. hoping that you get a chance to discover them yourself and try to think about it. I think the one thing you don't want to do, you don't want to memorize the seven indeterminate forms. You don't want to Google them. You want to try. Your best bet here is to try for understanding. Okay? You don't want to be an insect that just memorizes things. You want to go for understanding. And I'm proposing that we've got the tools for understanding. The tools are the bucket's point of view. If you think about the buckets, you will be very, very powerful, and you'll be in a good position to understand things rather than just memorize or Google. The worst thing you can do is just Google stuff and memorize, and then you don't get a chance to experience life on your own. So I really want to encourage you to go for understanding. Maybe I'll say a couple of things about this one. This is a really, really nice one because it shows the power of the buckets. So let's do it, okay? So here, you got to think, you've got a number that's really, really close to 1, and you raise it to the infinity. The powerful way to look at it is that you have something from the 1 bucket. Now think about it. What sort of things are in the 1 bucket? There are many, many things that are in the 1 bucket. Not all the 1s are created equal. Some 1s look like this, 9999999. Other ones look like this, 1.00001. Other ones look like 1.00007. Other ones look like 0.999995. See, not all 1s are created equal. The ambiguity comes here when you raise it to the infinity. Remember, we talked about anything, if it's larger than 1, say like 1.25, and you raise it to infinity, well, that gets incredibly big. That goes all the way to infinity. On the other hand, if it's 0.999 to the infinity, well, that gets to 0 because it keeps getting smaller. The 1 is sort of on the fence between these two possibilities. Depending on which item you pick from the bucket, it could go either way. It could go somewhere between 0 or infinity or somewhere in between. This should be probably not as obvious as infinity minus infinity, but if you think about it carefully using the perspective of the buckets of the equivalence classes, you see that there's no good conclusion here. There's no conclusion for sure. You can't say, well, it's got to be 1. No, because there's a lot of things in 1. Some 1s are a little bit less than 1 in this new way of looking at life. And some 1s are slightly larger than 1 in this new perspective. And so there comes the ambiguity. It's not for the faint of heart. So what are we going to do now? So let me propose this. The problem with this new arithmetic is exactly these indeterminate forms that presents for us the opportunity to present the medicine, the perfect medicine. And this is a good place to stop. Then the next time we meet, we will present the perfect medicine for these indeterminate forms. The perfect cure for these indeterminate forms will be precisely the idea of limits, which is an idea that, again, had been brewing over the last 2,000 years before Newton and Leibniz. And in the end, it delivered a very, very clean and rigorous way to deal with these indeterminate forms, which means we're putting the puzzle together. It means we're putting the puzzle together. We find out the areas, the problems or limitations, the brilliant idea that goes back to Archimedes, the need for a new type of arithmetic. Let's see if I can see that. Can you see that? The need for a new type of arithmetic. And the challenges that this new type of arithmetic presents, I can even write here, the challenges are the indeterminate forms. That right there, that's the challenge, which, of course, sets us up for the next lecture. The perfect medicine for that is going to be limits. Limits is the next piece of the puzzle here. That is what is going to help us deal with these indeterminate forms, which will help us deal with the area, which, it goes back to everything, and everything by now should start to make sense. At this point, I think I'm happy. This is our roadmap. This is what we got to do to experience a little bit of this Ninth Symphony. I think we should let the music play.
Hill.